and just emphasize on it a little bit more. So what we have here is an entangled pair of photons that have been produced. Okay. One of the photons goes to Alice, the other photon goes to Bob. Alice has a machine in which she can measure the polarization of the photon about an axis A. So it's polarization analyzer along A. Because now it's a photon experiment. It's not a standard light kind of experiment, rather a photon experiment. The quantum mechanics is totally equivalent. Both of these quantum systems can be represented on a block sphere. They are two-dimensional systems. And Bob analyzes his photon through a polarization analyzer that is oriented around B. Okay? So there is a certain probability. Okay, but there are two outcomes. A has two outcomes and B has two outcomes. Okay. Suppose that the photon is polarized along A after it passes through this analyzer, then the new state that is prepared is get A. Otherwise, it's minus A. For example, this is horizontally polarized. This would be get H. This would be get B. So these are two mutually orthogonal states that are produced. Okay. So let's call this outcome, let's give the measurement outcome a label plus 1, let's call this minus 1. This has two possible outcomes, plus 1 and minus 1. Alright. Now, if we were to define a function, let's define a function which is given in the question, which is probability plus AB plus probability minus AB minus probability plus AB minus probability minus AB. Let's call this function E AB. Now what does this mean? This means this is a probability that Alice's analyzer is along A, Bob's analyzer is along B, and both of them measure plus 1. Okay? This is a probability that both of them measure minus 1. This is a probability that one Alice measures plus 1, Bob measures minus 1, and this is the probability that Alice measures minus 1 and Bob measures plus 1. Okay? So these are probabilities. These are the sum or differences of probabilities. Okay, fine. So far, so good. Now, if you look at the coefficient of these probabilities, it's a 1 here, minus 1, and minus 1. So, this function is simply an average outcome. An average outcome on Alice's machine and Bob's machine. Alice can measure plus 1 or minus 1. Bob can measure plus 1 or minus 1. You multiply the measurement outcomes. The product of the measurement outcomes with the corresponding probabilities, you get an average outcome. Okay? So this function is just an average or an expectation value of the product of the outcomes. Correct? Because you just have the coefficient plus 1, minus 1, minus 1. We multiply by the corresponding probability. So this is just an average joint outcome. Okay. It's joint because it takes into account the outcomes on both Alice and Bob's machine. Okay. Now, this EAB, what value can this EAB take? It can take any value. It all depends upon the probabilities. Okay? But each outcome can be plus 1 or minus 1. Each product outcome can be plus 1 or minus 1. But then you have to look at the individual probabilities and find out what this correlation function is. Okay. Now, if we have a hidden variables model, okay, then some quantum state is being input, which is fixed, and then there are groups of particles that are produced. And each group is labeled by a hidden variable lambda. Okay, so if you talk about this system, there are two groups of particles, or four groups of particles that can be made. For example, if you make a table, Alice, Bob, one group is that Alice sees A, the other is that Alice sees minus A. So Alice sees A, and if this is a cat alpha, cat plus alpha kind of state. If this is cat alpha, this will be now this could be anything, because Bob's axis could be anything. Okay, so this could be cat B. Another group is, this is plus A, this is minus B, this is minus A, this is plus B, this is minus A, minus B. So four groups of particles can be made. Okay, so which means that lambda can take up four possibilities, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4. And you don't know which of these groups is produced. It's hidden from us. Okay. So if there is a local model that explains the outcomes, one can define an average outcome, PAB, based on the local 3D. So let's define an average outcome. There are different possibilities of lambda. Okay. It could be lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4. There are different possibilities in which the particles carrying definite identities are produced. There are four groups of particles. So this is one group of particles. Each particle that arrives at Alice has a fixed attribute, definite attribute. And the particle that arrives at Bob has a definite attribute. It's B. It's a B particle. This is an A particle. Correct? But you don't know which one of these groups is produced, because that is hidden from us through a variable, and it's defined by a variable lambda. So the average value of the measurement outcomes will be simply given by the regular formula for the expectation value. If we have lambda outcomes, and each lambda has a probability p lambda, okay, and we would like to find the average joint outcome. If Alice measures along A, given the value of the hidden variable is lambda, okay, and Bob, this capital B is a shorthand for Bob, this is a shorthand for Alice. Bob measures along the basis B, given the hidden variable has a value lambda, okay, then you integrate over lambda, over all the possibilities with respect to lambda. This will get you the expectation value of EA. The expectation value when Alice has her polarization analyzer oriented along A and Bob has his polarization analyzer oriented along A. Ab aap ye dekho ke acha aur hume ye bhi pata hai ki the sum of these probabilities has to be equal to 1, because the probability has to be over the entire volume of the hidden variable has to be equal to 1. Okay, now we have this expectation value. This is based upon a local hidden variable model. Okay, ab ye dekho, ye jo variable hai, ये प्लस वन हो सकता है या माइनस वन हो सकता है, और ये जो वेरिएबल है ये प्लस वन हो सकता है या माइनस वन हो सकता है, ऐसे ही है। अच्छा,
अब मुझे एक बात भी बताया कि अगर ये प्लस वन और माइनस वन के रूप में आता ठीक है, तो ये जो ई ए बी है इसके अगर आप बाउंड्स हैं, इसके कोई बाउंड्स हैं? The sum of the probabilities has to be equal to 1. क्या बाउंड होगी इसपे? E A B. Can this expectation value take up any value whatsoever? It's a real number, of course, but what are the bounds? Plus minus 1, it has to be less. This modulus value has to be less than 1. Okay, which means that E A B is bound on the upper side by 1 and is bound on the lower side by minus 1. Okay? Because the probabilities are just fractions, they are smaller than 1, and each of these products is equal to plus minus 1. It can only be plus 1 or it can be minus 1. Alright? So if this condition is satisfied, it's a convex sum of plus 1s and minus 1s. So this number itself will have a modulus that is smaller than 1. Perfect. ये हमें condition local hidden variable model से पता चला. अच्छा. Suppose I have four numbers x1, x1 dash, x2 dash. I have four numbers. And each one of these four numbers is either plus 1 or minus 1. Goes to my char number then. And I have x1 into x2 plus x2 dash plus x1 dash x2 minus x2 dash. Suppose I make this function. This is simply x1 x2 plus x1 x2 dash plus x1 dash x2 minus x1 dash x2 dash. Now what is the possible, what are the possible values of this function? If x2 and x2 dash are both equal to plus 1, suppose both of them are equal to plus 1, then this will go to 0. This will become 2. x1 can be plus 1 or minus 1. So this function can be plus 2 or minus 2. If x2 and x2 dash are both equal to minus 1, so both of them are equal to minus 1, so this will again be 0. Okay? So this will be minus 2 or plus 2. If one of them is plus 1 and the other is minus 1, then this term will go to 0 and this will become plus 2 or minus 2. So the only possibility that this function can take is plus minus 2. Alright. Now what do we have? What we have is, let x1 be a, Alice measures along a, small a, given the hidden variable lambda. x1 dash is Alice's measurement outcome when she measures along some other basis, a dash. Remember, a dash is not orthogonal to a, given the hidden variable lambda. Okay? So now we are introducing four bases. Alice can choose between two bases, a and a dash. x2 is b. Bob measures along b, given the hidden variable lambda. And x2 dash is the measurement outcome when Bob measures along b dash, given the hidden variable. Okay. Now, if I just insert these values into this, okay,
I will get,
remember,
each of these values is plus 1 or minus 1. So this condition is satisfied. So if I insert these values into this function, I will get a lambda, b b lambda, plus a lambda, b b dash lambda, plus a dash lambda, b b lambda, minus a dash lambda, b b dash lambda. Okay. This has to be equal to plus minus 2. Okay. Each of these products is plus minus 1. Okay. Now if I multiply this equation by b lambda and integrate over lambda, okay, then this becomes the expectation value of e a b plus expectation value a b dash plus the expectation value a dash b minus the expectation value a dash b dash. Okay? Alright? And if I multiply the right hand side, the integral of p lambda is just 1. So, what is this equal to? It's bound. Now it's bound on the upper and lower side to plus minus 1. Okay? Because the same reasoning that we give here. If this expectation value is bound by plus minus 1, then if I multiply this by p lambda, then this expectation value has to be, its modulus has to be less than 1. Its modulus has to be less than 1. Its modulus has to be less than 1. And this is negative and its modulus has to be less than 1. So this entire function is bound on the upper side and the lower side by plus by 2, by plus minus 2. Okay? Which means that E, if I call this function correlation function SAB, then SAB is less than or equal to 2, greater than or equal to minus 2. So if this condition is satisfied, then we can construct a local hidden variables model for the photons. Now what kind of experiment is being performed? The experiment that is being performed is that photons are being produced in an entangled pair, say 1 over under root 2, say left circularly polarized, right circularly polarized, minus right circularly polarized, left circularly polarized. Say this is an entangled pair of photons that's produced. Okay? It need not be in the horizontal vertical case, it could be in any case whatsoever. So this entangled pair of photons is produced, one goes to Alice, the other goes to Bob. Now Alice can choose her two kinds of measurement bases. She can choose to measure along A or she can choose to measure along A dash. Bob can likewise measure along B or he can measure along B dash. But four kinds of experiments take place. In the first run of experiments, Alice sets her, how do you measure polarization? By polarization analyzer. By polarizer that is rotated at a certain angle. If there is an outgoing photon, then the outcome is 1. If there is no outgoing photon, then the outcome is minus 1. Because it just blocks the photon. Right? A polarization analyzer is just a polarizer oriented at the proper angle. Isn't it? Physically, that's what a polarizer does. So, in the first round of experiments, Alice chooses her polarizer along A. Bob chooses her polarizer along B. Multiple copies of the incoming photons are available. And this PAB is constructed. Okay? Then this is constructed with the same setting of polarizers. Okay? Then this is constructed with the same setting of polarizers. And this is constructed with the same setting of polarizers. So multiple experiments are performed and you find a fraction of outcome in which a photon is available on this polarizer and a photon is available on this polarizer. Then you look at the fraction in which the photons are unavailable on both of these polarizers after both of these polarizers. What do you mean by a polarizer being available? I mean, it just has two outcomes, plus one and minus one. What does plus one mean physically? If you have a photon that is coming in, that is in a state at theta, polarized along theta. If you have a polarizer that is oriented along an angle theta, then this polarizer will transmit with 100% probability. Otherwise, it will be blocked with 100% probability. So you just, and if you put a detector here, if it clicks, then the outcome is plus one. If it doesn't click, the outcome is minus one. That's what you do. So you need a trigger as well. You need to see if the outcome, if the detector does not click, how do you know that a photon is actually being fired into the system? So how do you do that? You look at the second photon and don't look at its polarization. Or you don't look at its polarization, just place a detector here. And if this detector clicks, then there is some photon with some polarization that is available. So an entire pair has been produced, and if coincidentally at the same time a photon is observed here, then it means that an entangled pair has been produced. And if then it does not click, it means you can find out the polarization of this photon. So these kind of experiments are called coincidence detection experiments. So multiple experiments of this kind have now been performed in your body, photon, which means all kinds of properties. Okay. Now the second round of experiments, you change this polarizer axis to A dash, keep this at B. Then you perform another set of experiments, place this polarizer at A and this at B dash. You perform four sets of measurements, calculate those probabilities, calculate the expectation values, then you calculate this function SAB. And you will notice that for certain angles, for example, if this is A, this is B, this is A dash, this is B dash, and this mutual angle is 22.5 degrees, A, B, A dash, B dash, then this inequality is violated, strongly violated. The expectation value, A, B, given this, given an input state that is entangled, a Bell pair of photons, psi minus, the expectation value is given as cosine of 2 theta AB. This is something for you to do in the recitation. And remember, for spins, this factor of 2 goes away. Because the orientation of these polarizers, these are physical orientations. Whereas if you draw the Bloch sphere for a spin, if you draw the Bloch sphere for a spin, this is ket e, this is ket minus e. Okay? If you draw the Bloch sphere for a photon, this is ket h, this is ket b. Right? Because both of these are orthogonal states. However, if you would like to detect a polarizer along the vertical axis, you will have to rotate the polarizer by 90 degrees, not by 180. So that we can measure with respect to the polarizer that is along the horizon. So in physical space, the angles are by 90 degrees, whereas in the Hilbert space, or in the Bloch sphere, there is 2.8 degrees. That's why you have a factor of 2 with photon. Another way to look at this is that the spin of a photon is 1, whereas the spin of a spin half particle is 1 half. Okay? So the Bell inequalities are violated strongly if you set these as the mutual angles between the polarizers, between the polarization analysis. And this experiment was first performed in the 1980s. And if you use this value cosine 2 theta A, if you use this value for the expectation value, S turns out to be 2 into under root 2 theoretically, which is greater than 2. And and this violates the Bayesian theory. So a local hidden variable model is inadmissible. It's not permitted. You can prove that quantum mechanics is non-local without resorting to inequalities. And there's a proof in, a nice proof in the second article that I sent you, local action at a spooky action at a distance by Lucien Hardy. It has a GHZ proof which does not use inequalities. So don't have to resort to inequalities to prove that quantum mechanics is non-local. और एक बात याद रखो, ये जो मैंने आपको ब्रूटल फैक्ट ऑफ लाइफ में दिया था उसमें भी यही बात है कि इफ यू हैव अ स्टेट साइन और अ मिक्स स्टेट रो, अ डेंसिटी ऑपरेटर, दिस इज कंप्लीट नॉलेज अबाउट द स्टेट, कंप्लीट नॉलेज अबाउट द स्टेट. बट इफ यू पास फॉर एग्जांपल अ फोटोन इन स्टेट साइन थ्रू अ पोलराइजर that is, has its axis horizontal, and this is A H plus B V. You can't be sure whether the photon will be transmitted or not. So the outcome is totally probabilistic. But that does not mean that you did not have complete knowledge of the system, of the state. You had complete knowledge of the state. The weather is also unpredictable and it's also probabilistic whether it could rain or not. But it's not because you know, it's not because you have complete knowledge about the weather and you can't predict it. It's the unpredictability in weather is classical. It means that you don't have complete knowledge of the current conditions of the air currents, the air pressure, the humidity level. If you had precise knowledge of all the factors that go into determining whether it will rain or not, then you can accurately tell whether it's going to rain or not. If you have a coin and you toss a classical coin, if you actually know the exact forces that are acting on the coin, the air drops, the orientation with which it was initially flipped, you can actually predict with 100% probability that it will fall on two heads. But that's not true for a quantum system. You have complete knowledge of the system, but still the outcome is totally probabilistic. And what you can say at best is you can define probabilities. So quantum probabilities or quantum indeterminism is totally different from classical indeterminism. There is quantum indeterminism, but you have complete knowledge of the system. Still, the outcome is indeterminate. It's probabilistic in other words. You get to classical indeterminism or quantum indeterminism is zameen asman. ठीक है, अच्छा थोड़ा सा ये बेल्स एंड क्वालिटीज के बारे में एक और बड़ी मजे की बात करना चलो. Okay.
करने थोड़ी सी आपको कि कौन से एंगल्स हम एक्सिस किस तरह चूज करने के कि हम देखना चाहें कि ये इनइक्वालिटी वायलेट होती है नहीं एक्सपेरिमेंट को कैसे पता चलता है अब मैं एक सर्कल बनाता हूं ठीक है ए बी एंड सी आर जस्ट यूनिट वेक्टर्स पॉइंटिंग इन थ्री डिफरेंट डायरेक्शंस ओके सो आई टेक द सेंटर ऑफ द सर्कल ए सम वेक्टर ए मैं अभी इसके ऊपर हैट सी बना रहा याद रखो ये यूनिट वेक्टर ये बी एंड सम वेक्टर सी सो दिस इज थीटा ए बी ओके नाउ आई कनेक्ट दिस पॉइंट दिस इज ए माइनस बी वेक्टर मैग्नीट्यूड राइट द मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ ए माइनस बी दिस इज द मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ से A minus C, right? This is the magnitude of B minus C. And these are all vectors. The marker of the vector I am going to have. This angle is theta AB. Suppose that theta AB, first of all, let's see what is A minus B. A minus B is a is the side of a triangle squared. This is A squared. Plus b squared minus 2ab cosine of theta ab. Right? Cosine. Rule again. ठीक है? So this is 1 minus 2 cosine theta ab. This is 2 into 1 minus cosine theta ab. This is 4 sine squared. Okay. So if I look at this inequality transpires into the following. Sine square theta AB by 2 is A minus B modulus square has to be less than or equal to A minus C modulus square plus B minus C modulus square. Yes. The factors of 4 this cancel. Now this means that Bell's inequality will be satisfied if the modulus squared of this side is smaller than the sum of this squared plus the sum of this squared. Remember if these were not squared, this will always be satisfied because then it's going to be triangle. Sum of two sides of the triangle is 0. But these are squares. Okay. If now one can come up with three conditions. If theta AB is less than 90 degrees, देखो एक नया ट्राइंगल बना है. ये जो तीन साइड्स एक नए ट्राइंगल की तीन साइड्स है. वो ट्राइंगल ये है इस एंगल को मैं कह देता हूं अल्फा इफ दिस थीटा इज लेस देन 90 डिग्रीज सो व्हाट कैन आई से अबाउट अल्फा इज इट ग्रेटर देन इक्वल टू और लेस देन 90 has to be greater than 90 degrees. Right? In this condition satisfied alpha is greater than 90 degrees. Now when this is greater than 90 degrees, then the square of this side is greater than the sum of the square of these sides. Okay? You can verify that by the cosine rule. That is, this square plus this square minus 2 times this side is cosine of this angle is now greater than 90 degrees, cosine of an angle greater than 90 degrees is positive. So is negative, sorry. So this side squared is going to be smaller than the sum of this square plus this square. If this is simple geometry, if this angle is 90 degrees, then what is the value of alpha? Sorry,
in 1963. If this angle is pi, alpha equals 90 degrees. Okay.
एक पार्टिकल है, एक टू डायमेंशनल पार्टिकल, टू डायमेंशनल स्पेस में, और उसकी क्वांटम स्टेट एप्साइलन,
और वो कुछ जनरल स्टेट है अल्फा मैं उसको क्या कहूँ अल्फा जी प्लस बीटा माइनस जी राइट सपोज इट्स स्पिन हाफ पार्टिकल नाउ दिस स्टेट इज पोजेस्ड बाय एलिस दिस पार्टिकल इज पोजेस्ड बाय एलिस And there is Bob somewhere far away. Okay. Some distant location. He has a particle. He may or may not have a particle. The goal is that the state of this particle is transferred to Bob. Now, this is complete knowledge about the system of about the system that is possessed by Alice. Now, this complete information has to go over to Bob. The one possibility is that Alice makes a measurement of these coefficients alpha and beta. Okay, but for that she need multiple copies of this state of this particle. All preparatively identical, but that is impossible. One cannot prepare clones of this state. One suppose I give you a particle in this. Configuration in this quantum state, it is impossible to prepare clone using unitary operation. This is called the no cloning theorem. If I have time, I describe it. Otherwise, it's a 5-minute course. Otherwise, I'll describe it in the next class. You cannot have multiple copies of this state. You cannot make photocopies of quantum particles. Okay. And if you would like to calculate what these coefficients really are, you have to make multiple measurements. And if these are complex numbers, for example, if I have this state, I would like to measure alpha and beta. What I would like to do, I would like to measure the expectation value of Sx, the expectation value of Sy, and the expectation value of Sz. These three measurements can give me information about the complex numbers alpha and beta. Remember, alpha is a complex number, beta is a complex number. So how many real parameters do you need to describe this state? Two? Four? Because alpha has a real and imaginary part, so two real numbers with alpha, two real numbers with beta. So there are four parameters that are required. However, this state is normalized, which means that inner product state itself is one. So this is one constraint. So you have four real parameters. One constraint, you need three real parameters that will completely describe the state. The fourth parameter can come from the normalization equation. So you need three real parameters, you need three kinds of measurements. Sx, Sy, and Sz. So there's one appendix in your complementing Beck's book that describes this process. So you need multiple copies of the quantum state, but that is impossible. So it's impossible that Alice measures her state and transfers the information to Bob over telephone or fax or email. It's impossible to do that. The other possibility is that Alice just puts her quantum particle in a spaceship and sends it to Bob. But then there's a great likelihood, there's a very high likelihood of decoherence. That this state will disturb on its way, there could be magnetic fields in between, the magnetic fields can have a Hamiltonian that can make this state transform into something else. So the state will be disturbed as it goes from Alice to Bob. Alright? So quantum state transfer, as it is called. Perfect quantum state transfer over noisy channels is impossible. So you cannot measure the state, you cannot transfer the material from Alice to Bob. So quantum state transfer. One kind of quantum state transfer is transferring the material. The particle, this photon is picked up and put in an optical fiber and sent to Bob. But that's almost impossible. So how can one teleport or transfer the state of this particle to Bob? The key is through entanglement. Now how does entanglement work? One prepares two photons or two spins, for example, which are entangled in an entangled state. Okay? Suppose these spins are prepared in state 5 plus in the Bell state.
Okay.
So this Bell statement, what I'm trying to do, ket z plus ket minus z, right? It's an EPR pair of spins. One of these spins is physically transferred to Alice, and then goes to Bob. Okay, so an entanglement, there's an entangled pair of photons. Alice picks one photon, Bob picks the other. Bob goes away. Or Alice, both of them go away. Alright? Or in other words, an entangled pair of photons is produced, or spins is produced. One is transferred to Alice, the other is transferred to Bob. Okay? Now these, let's label these particles. This is particle number one. This is particle number two. This is particle number three. Remember, when this entangled pair was produced, particles number 2 and 3 were together. For example, a spin 0 particle could have decayed to give an entangled pair. So 2 and 3 had interacted in the past, somehow. They are correlated through this spooky effect called entanglement. Now 2 is transferred to Alice. Now this particle may have nothing to do with the state of 2. There could be no correlation between this particle and particle number 2. Particle number 3, however, goes to Bob. Okay? So particle number 3 has nothing to do with particle number 1. There is no correlation initially. Okay? So now it's three particles that we deal with. Particle 1, 2, 3. And if we write the quantum state, psi, the initial quantum state, before the teleportation protocol, it's basically this unknown state, which we wish to teleport, alpha ket z plus beta ket minus z, tensored with this, right? Tensored with phi plus. It's a three particle state initially, before the teleportation protocol has run its course. So we have alpha z plus beta minus z. Okay. One of the z plus minus z minus z. Psi is one of the alpha z. Plus alpha z minus z plus beta minus z z z plus beta minus z minus z minus z. Okay? Remember, there are tensor products. These are direct products in between, but I'm missing them out. Okay? The first ket in the first leftmost position belongs to particle 1, this is particle 2, this is particle 3. So if you like, you can put subscripts here if you like. But I think the order makes it really clear. Okay? So this is the initial state, the three particle quantum state. It's a tripartite system. There's entanglement between particle 2 and 3, but particle 1 is an unentanglement, either 2 or 3. So you can factorize this product in this form. Right? You can do the reverse process. Particle number 1 is unentangled with particles 2 and 3. 2 and 3 are mutually entangled. Okay, so this is the initial state. Now Alice performs a special kind of measurement on her two particles. She has two particles at her disposal, 1 and 2. Okay, that measurement that she performs is called a Bell state measurement. Now what is a Bell state measurement? Let me explain in 5 minutes what a Bell state measurement is. And this is also your first introduction to quantum computing. How do we prepare Bell states? We have a two particle system, right? So we need a basis that is four dimensional, z. One possible basis is zz, z minus z, minus zz, minus z, minus z. Suppose I have two particles at my disposal. I draw a quantum circuit. I perform a unitary operation on one particle and a unitary operation on the other particle.
Okay.
So I perform a unitary operation on the first particle, which is called a Hadamard operation, which you've already seen. Okay, a beam splitter can do a Hadamard operation. The unitary operator for the Hadamard operation, just acting on the first particle, is that it applies a transformation on the first particle and does nothing to the second particle. Okay? And the kind of transformation it does is E minus I pi S x plus S z under root 2. It's a 180 degree rotation on the tilted axis. It converts, okay, let me tell you what the Hadamard gain does. And it does nothing to the second part. Okay? The Hadamard gate basically does the following. UH is a transformation. If the input is kept Z, it produces kept Z plus kept minus Z. Right? If its input is minus kept Z, it produces kept Z minus minus kept Z. Right? It creates two rotations. So you just need to find the action of this unitary operator on two basis states. You completely make the matrix for this unitary operation. This is something you learn in quantum mechanics 1. Right? So in the Zeeman basis, this matrix is just going to be 1 over root 2, 1, 1, 1 minus 1. So what this does, this operation does, is that it creates a superposition on the first bit. Then you have another gate that is called controlled NOT gate. What the controlled NOT gate does is now this is a gate. Now this is a global gate. It acts on both qubits at the same time. It's not a local gate. So what this gate does, the unitary operation for the controlled NOT gate is that if the first qubit is in the state kept Z, it does nothing to the second state. Okay? And if the first qubit is in the state kept minus Z, it will flip this state. So if it's plus Z, it will make it minus Z. If it's minus Z, it will make it plus Z. So, and that flipping is a rotation about the x-axis by pi. A NOT gate is a pi rotation about the sx-axis.
Now, is this a separable state?
if we talk about two spins, is this a separable state, a non-entangled or an entangled state? It's non-entangled. It's simply z tends to z. It's non-entangled. It can be factorized quite well into two separate gaps. So if I have this circuit UH followed by the control knot, let's see what I get. Here I would get z plus minus z into 2 tensored with, nothing is happening to the second qubit so far. Here what would I get? The state would be, now this is zz plus minus zz. So here the state is going to be zz plus minus z into 2. Now is this an entangled state? Is the output of an entangled state? Why? It is entangled. So the input state is unentangled, the output state is simply this state, which is a Bell state. So this is how I can produce entangled states from separable states through a unitary operation. Okay. This, if my input is z, z, I get 5 plus. If my input is z minus z, I may get 5 minus or some other. If I input the four basis states, the separable states, I get the four Bell states. So this is how I produce Bell states. Now if I run, unitary operators are totally reversible. I can run them in reverse, okay, and recover the original state. Which means, now the inverse of a control knot gate is another control knot gate. Isn't it? So if I, after this circuit, I put in another circuit that is just the inverse of this circuit, I will recover my original state.
So this can the input state get?
This can the input state? Get z gets. Or output, you have Bell state.
5 plus r.
5 plus r. अगर मैं इसके आगे इसी यूनिटरी ऑपरेशन का इन्वर्स लगा दूं तो आई विल रिकवर दिस स्टेट बैक ओके नाउ व्हेन आई पुट इन द इन्वर्स ऑफ अ यूनिटरी ऑपरेशन आई हैव टू रिवर्स द ऑर्डर दिस इज यू वन यू टू द इन्वर्स विल बी यू टू डैगर यू वन डैगर सो फर्स्ट आई हैव टू अप्लाई द इन्वर्स ऑफ द कंट्रोल नॉट गेट द इन्वर्स ऑफ द कंट्रोल नॉट गेट इज द कंट्रोल नॉट गेट इटसेल्फ दो कंट्रोल नॉट गेट्स कैन टेक एन आइडेंटिटी ऑपरेशन ठीक है द इनवर्स ऑफ द हैडमार्क व्हाट्स द इनवर्स ऑफ द हैडमार्क गेट इट्स द हैडमार्क गेट इटसेल्फ द हैडमार्क गेट इज इटसेल्फ इनवर्स दो दफा सुपरपोजिशन और वापस स्टेट में आ जाए ठीक है इस मैट्रिक्स को मैं स्क्वेयर कर दूं अभी कहते आइडेंटिटी So I put in another Hadamard gate. So this circuit that I've drawn in blue is the complete inverse of this circuit. What this will do, if it inputs a Bell state, if I input a Bell state to this blue circuit, I will recover this state. Okay? So this circuit that I've drawn in blue, which I am now enclosing in pink, can interconvert, can convert an entangled state back to a separable state. So this state, this circuit in pink, this measurement in pink is basically called a Bell state measurement. Okay? So this kind of unitary operation, control knot followed by Hadamard gate on one qubit, is called a Bell state. Remember, it doesn't, it's immaterial whether you perform the Hadamard here and the control knot is reversed. It doesn't really matter. Just get global gradient here. So this is a Bell state measurement. Alice performs a Bell state measurement on her two qubits, on her two spins. Let's see what she gets. So this is the initial state that we're starting off with. Alice has at her disposal just these qubits, 1 and 2. right? She can't catch Bob's qubit because Bob's qubit is with Bob. Okay? Now let's see what happens. I move here.
You have to have a pair.
So Alice has to perform a Bell statement. Okay? So she starts off with, so the initial state is psi. And when she performs the Bell statement, when she does this in two steps. First she performs a controlled knot between 1 and 2. Right? This is what she does. Then we perform a Hadamard on the first one. So when she performs a controlled knot, 1 over under root 2 alpha. अब जब ये खा सकते हैं क्या होगा यहाँ से देख के कंट्रोल डॉट जी 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 ठीक है अगली टाइम कभी अल्फा जी माइ माइनस जी और आगे क्या है बॉब के पास क्या है माइनस जी उसको कुछ नहीं हो रहा थर्ड क्यूबिट को प्लस बीटा पहले क्यूबिट को भी कुछ नहीं हो रहा तो भी माइनस जी लेकिन अब जो सेकंड क्यूबिट है वो शी अप्लाइंग कंट्रोल नॉट बिटवीन क्यूबिट्स 1 एंड 2 क्यूबिट 1 इज द कंट्रोल क्यूबिट एंड क्यूबिट 2 इज द टारगेट क्यूबिट गुड गुड टू माइनस जी बॉब के पास क्या है जी अच्छा फिर बीटा माइनस जी प्लस जी बॉब के पास क्या है माइनस Okay, so this is after the control knot operation. The Bell statement is still not complete. Now what she does is she performs the Hadamard gate on qubit number 1. On 1. Okay, let's see what she does. 1 over and root 2 alpha z becomes. So I put in another 1 over and root 2 here, right? This becomes z plus minus z. Z, z. Okay? Yaad rakho, isme tensor products hain. Toh baar baar tensor products ki confusion ho jayegi. Ya bahut clumsy ho jayegi confusion. Z alpha z plus minus z. So this is Alice's qubit. Minus z, minus z. The key is that the correlation between the qubits is being untouched. Plus beta. Now this becomes z minus minus z. Minus z. Z. Plus beta. Z minus minus z. Minus z. Minus z. Okay. Now what I would like to do, I would like to just expand this qubit. Okay, not too tedious. At 1 over root 2, 1 over root 2, alpha, z, this is like ZZZ, right? Just to save time. Okay. Plus, minus ZZZ, the size of alpha. Plus z minus z minus z plus minus z minus z minus z. Plus beta z minus z z minus minus z minus z. Plus z minus z minus z minus minus z minus z minus z. Okay. This beta. Okay, so this is the new quantum state that has been prepared. Alright. Now let's do the following. Let's try to factorize this state.
Let's see here.
Either.
Either?
ये माइनस ही ये माइनस है ना फ्रैगमेंट
तीनों माइनस ही तो एक प्लस
माइनस ही प्लस हो जाएगा ना मुझे नजर नहीं आ रहा
अब उसके बारे में भी चीज जो
अच्छा है
मीटर बन
मीटर
इसके बराबर है नहीं नहीं इस ये जाने चीज के इसके बिल्कुल बराबर जो है लेफ्ट पे
ये प्लस हो रहे इसको कुछ भी नहीं है इससे क्या है
वो भी चीज लिखा
माइनस सी ये देखो यहां क्या था या माइनस था ये माइनस है ना ये माइनस है तो ये प्लस हो गया इसके प्लस हो गया ये प्लस हो जी जी माइनस जी ओके नाउ व्हाट आई वुड लाइक टू डू आई वुड लाइक टू डू अ बिट ऑफ फैक्टराइजेशन आई वुड लाइक टू सेपरेट आउट आई वुड सी इफ आई कैन फैक्टराइज दिस लेट्स ट्राई
1 over 2.
Now look at these terms. This term and this term. Okay. So what does this term mean? This term is really z.
First qubit, second qubit z.
Tensored with alpha get z plus beta get z. I can factorize them. Right? The first two qubits, they are common. They are in a common state. Get z cross to get z. The third qubit, however, is in a superposition. Get z plus minus z with the appropriate coefficients. Now let's look at two more terms. Let's look at z minus, let's look at this term. And this term. Minus z crossed with z crossed with alpha z minus beta minus z. Okay. Plus the remainder terms. Minus z crossed with minus z crossed with alpha minus z minus beta z or prime. Okay. Now what Alice has done, let's see what Alice has done. Alice has two qubits at her disposal. Qubit or spin two spins, spin one and spin two. Right? So she performs a control NOT gate and then a Hadamard gate. And some new state is prepared here on her qubits. Right? Now what she does is she measures if these are spins. She puts in a Stern Verlag apparatus here, SDZ, and a Stern Verlag apparatus here, both along the Z direction. The two possible outcomes. Either she can get plus H bar by 2, or minus H bar by 2, plus minus here. Alright. So she has two qubits at her disposal. She puts a Stern Gerlach apparatus in front of each spin. And there are four possible outcomes that she can measure. Alright. What are the four outcomes? Now, if you look at this quantum state, when she makes a measurement, it will collapse into four possible states. What are those states? We're not concerned about Bob's qubit. Bob's qubit is something else. This is Bob's qubit, number three. This is Alice's system. What state would Alice's system collapse into? So look at Alice's qubits. Alice's qubit ke pushpa ya ki ye hi hai ya ye hai ya ye hai ya ye hai. The wave function has to collapse. So what state would Alice's qubits collapse in? Basic quantum mechanics. Alice ki paas dekho kaun se do qubits hai, kaun se do spin halves hai. Usko kya nazar aayega yahan pe? Usse ek nayi state prepare kar li yahan pe. और जब उस टर्न के लाइक जब वो मेजर करेगी दी व्हाट शी इज मेजरिंग इज शी इज मेजरिंग द एंगल ऑफ मल्टीपल ऑन द सी एक्सिस दैट्स व्हाट द टर्न के लाइक अपरेटस इज डूइंग शी विल प्रिपेयर सम न्यू स्टेट्स द एक्ट ऑफ मेजरमेंट इज कोलैप्सिंग दिस वेव फंक्शन इनटू न्यू स्टेट्स व्हाट आर दोस न्यू स्टेट्स क्या द कोलैप्स कैन टेक प्लेस इन फोर पॉसिबल स्टेट्स बाहर नहीं होनी चाहिए और z माइनस z और माइनस z क्रॉस z माइनस z और माइनस z क्रॉस माइनस z राइट इफ दिस चैनल फायर्स शी गेट्स अ कैट z इफ दिस चैनल फायर्स शी गेट्स अ कैट z एंड सो द स्टेट दैट शी प्रिपेयर्स कैट z क्रॉस कैट z If this channel fire state that she could be minus E cross plus E. So what's the probability that either of these states is being prepared? 1/4, because this is 1/2 equal probability amplitude for all of these four possibilities. So 1/2 plus square is 1/4. So this state is prepared with a probability of 25%. This state is prepared with a probability of 25%. This state is prepared with a probability of 25%. Okay? Now, she has four possible outcomes. Okay? Now, if you have four possibilities and you would like to inform Bob, she would like to inform Bob the outcomes of her measurements of a Bell state measurement experiment. Okay? There are four possible outcomes. How much information does she need to transmit to Bob? She just needs to measure which one of these four outcomes to measure. So if Alice and Bob have decided on a code, for example, she needs to tell Bob one out of four possibilities. For example, they could have decided that okay, if this is my outcome, I will call it 0. If this is my outcome, I will call it 1. If this is my outcome, I will call it 2. If this is my outcome, I will call it 3. They need to decide on four symbols to communicate. And it is a one-way communication. Alice transports this message to Bob over a classical channel. Over a classical channel, over phone, email, which is bound by the speed of light. She cannot transfer information faster than the speed of light. Okay? So she transfers a message over a classical channel to Bob. Okay? And if this information transmission were taking place on a binary channel, she would just need 2 bits. Because these 4 numbers can be encoded in 2 bits. This could be 0001101. She just needs 4 bits. Oh, sorry, 2 bits. So she sends a two-bit message to Bob, telling her which outcome has she actually achieved. Now Bob, looking at the outcome, can adjust his own 2-bit so that it perfectly matches the initial state that Alice possessed. If the outcome which Alice receives, which Alice measures, is get Z, then Bob already has a perfect copy of the original 2-bit which Alice possessed. This is just Alice's original 2-bit. So even if Alice doesn't transmit any information, 25% of the times Bob's 2-bit is going to be exactly the same as Alice's original 2-bit. Even though Bob's 2-bit has nothing to do with Alice's 2-bit, Bob's 2-bit was part of an entangled pair. And the entangled pair was received, one of the entangled photons was spin was received by Bob before the other pair had ever interacted with Alice's 2-bit. So, if the message that Bob receives is that this is the outcome of Alice, he will do nothing to his 2-bit, he will be happy and confident and satiated and satisfied that his 2-bit is a perfect copy of Alice's 2-bit, Alice's state. Remember, both the original qubits, the original states of these 2 qubits is destroyed because the wave function has collapsed. Okay? If, however, Alice measures this to be an output, Bob needs to adjust his qubit. Okay? So that it matches the original. How can we adjust his qubit? So there are 4 possible outcomes. If the message received is 0001101, right? If the message received is 00, then Bob's qubit is an exact copy of Alice's qubit. Okay, so this is Bob's reality now. This is Bob's world. So Bob has his qubit, he receives this classical message over a phone call from Alice. He does nothing to his qubit, and this qubit that Bob possesses is simply alpha z plus beta minus z. It's an exact copy of Alice's quantum state. So Bob has to do nothing. So he just applies a unitary operator. He says do nothing. He does nothing. If Alice has measured 0 minus 1, 0 z minus z, which I am denoting by this symbol, okay, then the qubit that Bob possesses, he knows whatever it is, it's, suppose it's alpha minus z plus beta z. He has to do something to convert it to the Alice's. What does he need to do? He has to flip his book, which means he has to apply sigma xk. Sigma x is a unitary operation which is simply e minus I pi s x over h bar, remember. It's a 180 degree rotation. Every unitary operation is a rotation. So this sigma x is simply this. Okay, if you expand this using the theorem that we have, cosine pi minus iota sine pi, you get sigma x. Okay? So this is a 180 degree rotation on the x-axis, which is just a sigma x operator. It's a unitary operator, sigma x operator. Okay? Good. So if this operation is applied onto this qubit, the final state will be alpha z plus beta minus z. And you can prove this on your own as well, okay? You can prove this. Write the matrix form of sigma x. Sigma x is simply 0 bar 1, 0, right? This matrix acts on, you have beta here and you have alpha here. Right? So this is your gap. Okay? So this output is alpha,
beta.
Okay? So we just apply this Pauli operator, which is a unitary operator. With an iota sign, it's a unitary operator. It's this operator proportional to sigma x, and he recovers Alice's. So depending on the message he receives, he applies a unitary operator, local unitary operator, nothing to do with Alice's qubit, and recovers the original state. If this is Alice's message, so this is the state that Alice has measured, then he would need to apply another transformation. What transformation does he need to apply?
Sigma?
Z. Exactly. In vitro by sigma z transformation. Okay, which is E minus I by S z over h bar. With a proportionality. Okay? You will recover the original state of sign. Okay? If this is the outcome, what does it need to apply? So this is Bob's qubit now. He needs to flip and also reverse the signs. So he needs to apply sigma y operation. Sigma y operation is really a sigma x operation followed by a sigma z operation with some proportionality constant, some global constant. So he just needs to apply a sigma y operation. And the state of Alice's qubit will be perfectly transferred with an extremely high fidelity, theoretically approaching 1, to Bob's world. So this is how teleportation takes place. The original state is destroyed. What is a state is just the coefficients alpha and beta. That's all there is to the state. All there is to a pure state, nothing more, nothing else. So these coefficients are transferred to beta, but a classical communication channel is necessary. So this process is limited by the speed of light. You cannot have super luminal communication. So this is how teleportation works based upon entanglement. The really interesting, the weird thing is that Bob has a qubit and Bob's qubit is somehow being determined by the measurement that Alice makes. And Bob can apply a unitary operation depending upon the outcome that Alice makes. Alright?
Bob has a qubit and is it?
Within the entangled pair, one Bob ne le liya, dusra Alice ko le liya.
Alice ke paas original
state thi na sir. Iske paas kuch nahi. Ha, uska Bob ka jo qubit hai wo Alice ke original qubit se kisi tarah interact nahi hua.
Sir, agar hum wo bell state koi aur lete to
koi aur lete to inki yahan pe usse kaise pata hai lagana to kaise next pe lekin you would always have this 4 point.
Thank you.